Welcome to the second office hours. I have Sebastian here and myself, and we're gonna do this the same way we did last time. First, we're gonna talk about some content, and then we're gonna go into some applications, referring mostly to Kalman filters, but also talking a little bit about Stanley and Junior.
Okay, what's the first question?
First question, both of the content questions actually have to do with linear algebra.
Mm-hmm.
So, when we were talking about this state transition matrix F,
mm-hmm.
we had this equation X prime equals F times X plus U. And you said that this U is the motion. But the motion seemed to be embedded in this F matrix, in that the velocity was taken from the state with the F matrix. So what exactly is going on with U?
So U allows you to apply a choice. Like when we just said the position is a function of velocity, that's describing physics, but it doesn't give you a choice. So when you want to insert a choice into the system, like for example, you might want to change accelerations and that affect velocity and affect states. That choice is expressed with the vector u. We didn't really use it because we were tracking things. We didn't know how they're being actuated. So we set u to zero in our example. But if you have control over the system you're trying to track and you can insert like a motion yourself, then you use the vector u.
Okay, interesting. And just one other piece of intuition we're hoping to get is a lot of the matrices we talked about, they either didn't have off-diagonal elements, or we at least didn't initialize any off-diagonal elements. So specifically in the P, the covariance matrix, and the R matrix, can you give us some intuition about what those off-diagonal elements would represent?
So we actually ran into an example that didn't have off-diagonal elements. We didn't initialize it, but when the velocity became correlated with the position, when we realized, oh, the faster we move, the further we are to the right, that was expressed by an off-diagonal element. And they turn into correlations. So the larger these elements are, the more two variables are actually correlated. The more knowledge about one variable tells you something about another variable.
Okay, thank you. So now, let's get into some of the applications that the students seem especially interested in. Specifically, this R matrix, where does it come from? How do we get it in real life? What are we doing with our sensors?
Right. So the noise matrices, they express how noisy your sensor is. And at first approximation, you would say, oh, let's just measure what the variation of the measurement is and then plug it in. But because these filters, very subtle thing, assume conditional independence, they assume that noise is independent from one type to the next, whereas in reality it isn't. They're typically set by hand. So typically you start with a very large value and see, and you look at the result. And if the result looks good to you, you leave it that way. Unfortunately, there's no good science for it. A while back, together with Andrew Ng, I published a paper on how to learn the noise matrix, but that goes way beyond this class.
Okay, thanks. And so you mentioned that Stanley and Junior both use laser and radar.
Mm-hmm.
Does each one offer something unique, or are they basically both just doing the same thing? And either way, how do we incorporate measurements from two sources into our Kalman filter?
So these are two questions. First of all, laser and radar at first approximation do the same thing. They measure how far things are away. Radar also measures how fast they're moving through the Doppler effect. But their characteristics are very different. They measure different things. There are certain elements that can only be measured by laser, others just by radar. In fact, laser tends to have much higher like spatial resolution, but when it becomes foggy, the wavelength of light tends not to be as good as a radar wavelength. So they're somewhat complementary. To incorporate both, Bayes rule allows you to incorporate sensor measurements one after another. So if you have a laser and a radar, you just multiply both of them in, and that's just fine.
Okay, great. The top-rated question actually was about the programming languages used in Stanley and Junior. Was it Python? Was it something else? And how do you make a decision?
It was not Python, honestly.
Okay.
At the time, we started out with C, but then C++ became very popular. It was popular, and ended up with a better choice. So almost all the code is written in C++.
Okay. And how do you make that decision when you're starting a project this big? Is there debate?
There is always debate. The beauty of C++ is it's very efficient in execution. And when you use it right, it can be very powerful if you don't abuse it. It has way too many things built in. But some of the things like the classes are just really, really good. And then, look, then you hire people and you work with students and some of them like Java, so they write their code in Java, and others like C++ and they just write Python or Ruby on Rails. And then we just bring all the stuff together.
Okay. And thinking of Stanley and Junior, what were the major hardware and software differences between the two vehicles?
So Stanley had about six embedded processors. Junior had two PCs with quad cores, so there was a more integrated system. The biggest difference in the hardware were actually the sensors. Stanley had very, very cheap and simple laser rangefinders as their main sensor. We did have radars, but we didn't use them much. Whereas Junior had a much, much richer sensor suite. Junior could look in all directions. We called this surround sensing, whereas Stanley could only look straight ahead.
Okay. And so that thing we saw spinning on the top of Stanley, that was the laser rangefinder?
So what you saw spinning on the top of Stanley was actually on Junior.
That was on Junior, okay.
Yeah, you never saw anything on Stanley because there was nothing spinning there.
Okay, on Junior. And that was a laser rangefinder.
Right. And that one spins because it looks in all directions. And it was important for city driving because what's behind you actually matters in cities. Whereas if you drive a desert trail, there's no other traffic, you don't have to look back.
Right, right. And that's a good segue into the next question, which is, what's the next big challenge? We've done deserts, we've done urban driving.
The next challenge is to take over our cars, basically. Okay. Get this technology into every single car and make sure driving is safe. And every person has a special button that says, like my little chauffeur button, I want to just drive automatically. And then I'm just going to get home without having to pay attention.
And finally, how comfortable is it? Do these cars drive like similar to the way you or I would drive?
So when we first started it out, I would always say the driving is effective, but not elegant. And you would get in the car, you know exactly what I mean. So the steering wheel would go like this all the time. And mm-hmm. It would make a lot of noise. And it was pretty clear you were inside a robot. And it would, from the outside, it looked really great. From the inside, it didn't. But as things moved on, if you get into a Google car right now, you won't be able to distinguish from human driver. It's really rock solid. The steering wheel stays like this. When it turns, it confidently drags it around, moves the right direction, comes back. It's actually come a long way.
And to get from what you said to where we are now, was it low pass filtering? What was the main, what were we doing?
We will have a class on control. And the control techniques ended up to be very sophisticated, but also very, very good. All the kind of motion of the steering wheel were all related to inaccuracies. And they came from multiple sources. Some of it was that we weren't processing our GPS data good enough yet, and our map data. Some of it is the map resolution. Like if you have a 10, 15 centimeter grid cell, and your estimate jumps from one grid cell to the next, or your particle filter jumps a little bit around, that might not look dramatic on a screen, but if you turn to steering motion, and your steering wheel goes by 2, 3, 4 degrees, that's really bad. We had a sensor that tracks the angle of the steering wheel, and the spatial resolution was about a degree. And that means you couldn't quite know what the angle of steering wheel is, so you would drive a little bit blind, like up to a degree. And a degree of steering wheel doesn't sound like much, but it's actually a lot. And you can try this out. If you drive a car, and even if you move it by one degree, you feel a noticeable effect. So you'd find out after a while, oh, we actually pulled in this direction, let's drag it back. And that, all that stuff you kind of fix.
Okay, so we'll learn about that in, I think, Unit 5, PID controllers?
Yeah.
Excellent, I can't wait.
All right.
Thanks a lot.
All right, take care.